When you go to a friend's house, you ring the bell, they see you and identify you. Then they let you in. Depending on the trust you both have, you may have access to some of the rooms of the house. For example, the dining room and the bathroom. It would be impolite and probably could get you kicked out if you start exploring areas of the house where you are not allowed. On the other hand, if you book a reservation in a hotel, they may have your personal information in their systems. They will have a front desk where they will validate your identity and give you an access card. With this access card, you can access some facilities like the pool, the gym, your room, and maybe even get some free stuff like a drink. You don't need to verify your identity again at each of the facilities, and this is not the same access an employee in the building would have. Like the example with your friend's house and the hotel, there are differences when building secure monoliths versus building secure microservices, and today we're going to talk about them. I'm Christian, and you're watching A Dev Story. In order to understand how to build a secure microservice, it helps to first understand how a secure monolith application works. It starts with the user making a request to our application. In order to be secure, this request has to be over an encrypted channel, like TLS. Our application then needs to ask for an authentication factor. This is a way for us to validate who the user is and check against a trusted database. This can be, for example, a password. In security terms, the user, or more generically, an authenticated entity, is called the principal. We now can create a session. The session defines a context for the time the user is allowed to make operations inside our application. The security context contains details about the principal, who they are, and what access do they have. We can check the context at different layers of the application to be sure it has the right access. In the case of our friend's house visit, they verify our identity at the door by matching their memory of who we are. Our visit is marked by a session. We can stay there forever after all. And the security context is his memory of us. In the microservices world, this changes a lot, because now you don't have only one instance of the application, you have multiple instances, and you also have multiple services. So it's not possible to share the in-memory session between all of them, and it would be cumbersome to have each of these services implement their own user database that they can trust and make every user authenticate their request against them. Imagine authenticating the hotel users on every facility instead of just at the beginning in the front desk. It would be time-consuming as well as unsafe, as many non-authenticated users can get inside the hotel before checking for their identity. So how do we do authentication now? Similar to the hotel front desk, there is a similar pattern in microservices that we can use, that is called the API gateway. An API gateway is a service that sits between the users and the microservices that are behind it. It can do multiple things, but one of the things that it can do is to authenticate the users before they reach the microservices. There are different standards to do authentication. One of the most common ones is oAuth. When you authenticate the users in the API gateway, the session becomes globally available between all the services. Sharing the security context is now also more complex. Before, you just inject the security context inside your application and you can verify that at different layers. But now you did authentication in the API gateway, so you need to pass that information to the rest of the services that would be doing the verification of access or authorization of this request in their systems. The most common way to do this is using tokens. There are different types of tokens, but some of the standards are, for example, JWT or PASETO. Authorization is then done by checking the permission the token has inside that specific service, similar to how the hotel card reader checks that your badge has access to your room. You can also track what each user has been doing by keeping an unmodifiable access log, like we saw in the event sourcing video. That can be used for audit purposes in case someone accessed something that they shouldn't have. The hotels, for example, have access logs and security cameras. You can also protect not only what resources the user have access to, but how much of it they do. This is useful, for example, to prevent denial of service attacks, or in other words, to guarantee the availability for legit users. This is typically done using a mechanism called rate limiting. This requires the definition and enforcement of quotas, which are the amount of resources a given principal can consume. In the case of the hotels, for example, they check if you already had breakfast, so you can't have breakfast twice. We have seen how a typical microservices architecture is securized. The investment that you do in security should always be based on the risk that you're willing to assume. Security depends a lot on the context. Something considering secure in one scenario might not be in another. And it's not possible to have a 100% secure application, or it might be cost prohibited to do so. When you're designing the security for your application, there are different aspects that need to be considered. The first one is, what are the assets or resources that you want to protect? This could be the database contents, or maybe personal identifiable information that you want to protect. The second one is, what are the security goals that are important for you? A security goal is what security means for your assets. There's not only one definition of security. The most famous security goals are the CIA Triad, which includes confidentiality, integrity, and availability. But your system can have different ones. It could have also accountability or non-repudiation. So security goals can be seen as non-functional requirements, like we saw in the software architecture video, that are important for your security. Third, you need to consider the environment in which your system is going to operate and what are the specific threats present on that environment. The first thing that you need to consider here is, what are your trust boundaries? A trust boundary is the frontier where a program's data or execution changes its level of trust. Think, for example, in the case of your friend's house. There are two different trust boundaries there, what is outside and what is inside. So they have a verification at the door where they confirm who can enter their home and who are allowed into that inside home trust boundary. Second thing that you need to do is to consider what are the threats and vulnerabilities that are present. To identify threats, you can do threat modeling, and one of the most famous frameworks is the Triad model. To identify vulnerabilities, you can go, for example, to the OWASP site, where they publish the different vulnerabilities that are present and what are the most common ones and how to mitigate them. And fourth, you also need to consider what are the mechanisms that you have in order to mitigate those threats and vulnerabilities that we saw before. Some of these, we already saw them today, like encryption, authentication, access control, audit logging, and rate limiting. But there are more, like, for example, input validation that we didn't touch on today. Besides the differences in how to apply the security concepts in monoliths versus in microservices, vulnerabilities haven't changed that much in the past few years. And security models like Stride are still very much valid. If you take a conscious approach and apply the security mechanisms that we saw today, you will have a more secure service. Thanks for watching.